Legacy, Wisdom of African Traditions and the Bible. Written by Chris Morehouse. Narrated by T.J. Pryor-Wells. For Lee and Logan. A portion of the proceeds will be donated to a charity that serves Africa and the Caribbean. Foreword. Only a fool tests the depth of a river with both feet. Meaning, you don't jump straight into a situation without thinking about it first. The above is a Nigerian proverb that warns us of the foolishness of decisions made without thought. If one hastily jumps into a river with both feet, they may drown, not knowing the depth of the water, or they may lose their footing to avoid the grasp of an alligator. That causes me to consider the depth of the invitation given to write the foreword for this amazingly thoughtful book, which parallels the proverbs of Africa with those proverbs and wise sayings found in the texts of the Hebrew and Christian Bibles. Additionally, African proverbs from historically Muslim societies offer another opportunity for reflection. All three Abrahamic traditions have profoundly affected human wisdom around the world. One thing we should first acknowledge is that Africa is the birthplace of humanity, culture, language, and wisdom. That birthing has now migrated to many continents and countries around the globe. No wonder when we read the ancient proverbs of Africa, we can find similarity in most, if not all, cultures, traditions, and peoples near and far. In most instances, the wisdom is to be mindful of oneself and of others. Or, as it is written coming from Jesus in the Christian tradition, love your neighbor as yourself. That love was expressed once with my witness of my Ghanaian neighbor, whom, while musing on the similarities of the Asante of Ghana and the Igbo or Igbo of Nigeria, both next-door neighbors in the U.S., proclaimed, "I can't help but believe that, in an earlier time, we were one." This wisdom and legacy of love and discernment in our actions is told in various ways, everywhere. In this 21st century, it should remind us that there is no real separation among us except what we create for desires of dominance, control, and safety for our favored groups. I am reminded of an early conversation I had with a wise clergywoman as I began an effort to uncover racism in our particular segment of the larger church. We were going to identify ourselves as a group looking at race and reconciliation in our named geographical location of our larger denomination. I was advised by this pillar in our church to take some time to reconsider the word reconciliation for those of African descent, as in most of our circumstances, we had never conciled in the first place. In the Hebrew, kafar means to cover, to atone or condone, to placate or cancel. In other more modern words, to pay back or repair. As I picked up this manuscript, first of all, not to read, but to put the pages in their proper order, I saw and felt the reconciliation of humanity amongst these pages. It became clear that we are one creation, and though we may come in different languages, forms, and cultural distinctions, our purpose here is to sustain life, to respect the created order, and to share our gifts or reparations with all, but especially those who have been offended. To offend creation is to offend the Creator, who proclaimed, "They are like us." Though we may do so in different ways, when we honor and respect one another and our varying paths, we live out the perichoresis from Greek rotation of the Trinity, Creator, Creation, and Life-Giving Spirit. It is a term referring to the relationship of the three persons of the Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to one another. read this book with gratitude for your place in the divine dance. Therese Taylor Stinson, writer, spiritual director, ordained deacon, and ruling elder in the Presbyterian Church, USA. Silver Spring, Maryland, April 2023. Introduction. Go back and get it. That's the literal meaning of sankofa, a concept of the Akan people of Ghana. More broadly, it's an instruction to go forward, look to the past. To understand where we are and where we are going, we can learn from those who have gone before. One way of doing this is to explore proverbs, which represent a collective inheritance, a legacy, that is passed on from the generations who have gone before us. The many peoples of Africa have a rich legacy of wisdom traditions embodied in their proverbs. I have always loved and collected African proverbs. I love their conciseness as well as their depth. They encapsulate insights that can sink deep into your soul. A few years ago, light bulbs started going off for me as I began exploring the parallel sayings books, which juxtapose insights from the great religious traditions with their counterparts from Jewish and Christian scriptures, i.e., the Bible. These books explore resonances between Christianity and Judaism, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, and Taoism. I wondered about the absence of a similar volume exploring corresponding insights from Africa's wisdom traditions. The result is legacy. To be sure, there are some differences between the parallel sayings books and this volume. First, of course, African proverbs generally, but not exclusively, reflect oral traditions, while the corresponding teachings from other faith traditions often come from written texts. One is reminded, however, that parts of the Bible were originally spoken or even sung, and other parts were not committed to writing for many years. Second, of course, African proverbs do not represent a single tradition. They are as diverse and rich as the continent of Africa itself. They come from historically Muslim societies such as the Swahili, nations with ancient Christian traditions like Ethiopia, and those with robust contemporary Christian communities such as South Africa that have advanced justice and reconciliation, and peoples with vibrant traditional religions such as the Yoruba, whose religious practice has found expression in the New World and who are now majority Christian. Third, of course, African proverbs are not a religion per se. However, like religion at its best, they do possess deep insight into the human condition. Moreover, many embrace paradox or non-dual ideas that find expression in mature religion. Also, it's worth noting that traditional African societies did not assign religion to a separate domain, but instead infused it in daily life in myriad ways. The proverb's religious dimension is also reflected in the way they speak to the life of community and in the way they can deepen knowledge of self, God, and others. They are glimpses into sophisticated thought traditions. Why am I using such a narrow lens to examine the thought traditions represented here, using Bible verses shorn of their original context? Because comparing Bible passages to African proverbs offers a fresh opportunity to ponder their meanings and perhaps develop new understandings, much as Jesus gave his followers many opportunities to understand by telling different parables. Indeed, the Bible passages cited on the following pages are gateways into verses and stories that can yield great insights when explored on their own. Furthermore, some readers may observe that the African proverbs do not provide a comprehensive understanding of the traditions they represent. Indeed, they are glimpses of complex thought traditions that are worth exploring on their own. Legacy merely offers an opportunity to ponder some resonances. In many cases, the selected African proverbs reflect the perennial tradition, universal principles that find a voice in many cultures and societies. Some readers will be familiar with the idea that all have been included in God before the world was made. Ephesians 1, 3, and 4. If we trust this, we should expect to find resonances in other traditions. In addition, many readers will be familiar with the idea that the Holy Spirit, or Sophia, moves as she will, imparting wisdom and guiding human hearts. According to the Bible, she stands at the city gate, raising her voice for all humanity. Listen, for I have trustworthy things to say. I open my lips to speak what is right. Proverbs 8:6. It should not surprise us that she also has an African voice, one that is distinctive and beautiful. While wisdom is universal and inherent in the human condition, accumulating it necessarily involves many hearts and minds. It's a communal effort, often taking place over generations. According to an Akan proverb, wisdom is like a baobab tree. No one individual can embrace it. I must acknowledge those who have gone before me. In my efforts to corroborate the proverbs, I found compilations that in some cases dated to the 19th century, likely reflecting oral traditions that presumably long predated these volumes. However, such compilations rarely pair the proverbs they cite with Judeo-Christian wisdom literature. Interested readers may also wish to consult an online resource, www.afroprov.com, which in some cases does compare selected proverbs with Bible verses. However, I am aware of no other compilation with as large and diverse a collection of proverbs that are compared to Bible verses. Some notes about the proverbs featured in Legacy are in order. In my efforts to corroborate the proverbs, I encountered some attribution issues. In general, I have preferred as specific an attribution as possible, but in some cases, the sources cited only a country and not a specific group within the country. In other cases, I found some proverbs that were attributed to more than one tradition. I have identified these with a note. Additionally, I have included some proverbs with diaspora communities in the Caribbean that were also featured in the sources I used. Although I found some proverbs in their original languages, I use only the English versions in this volume. Furthermore, in a few cases where the source used a dialect of English, such as Caribbean Patois, I have chosen to include only the standard English versions here. Finally, in selecting corresponding Bible verses, I have generally tried to use the New International Version, NIV, for reasons of accessibility and clarity. When referring to the languages spoken by the Swahili and Zulu peoples, I use the term Swahili and Zulu for clarity, rather than Kiswahili and isiZulu, which, although they are correct, may be less familiar to readers. In addition, the categories used to organize the proverbs, such as golden rule, speaking and listening, love, seeing, and forgiveness, are mine. Other potential ways to group the proverbs may be valid because proverbs can be ambiguous and have more than one potential meaning. While the selected proverbs could be grouped differently, I have opted to avoid repetition. Nevertheless, readers may consider the various facets of the selected proverbs. Another issue is that since wisdom is a river with many tributaries, it may be impossible, in some cases, to determine whether the proverbs are truly parallel or reflect existing Christian influences. The Zulu proverb about trees bearing fruit, for example, cited in the section Fruits of the Spirit, is an African expression of the biblical idea, according to my sources. The Ethiopian proverb about conspicuous prayer, which you will hear in the section about prayer, may be another example given the long Christian history of that country. Even if that is the case, the Ethiopian version has a vividness that may linger in the mind and cast fresh light on the corresponding Bible verse. As compelling as this juxtaposition of various wisdom traditions may be, It is just a start, and therefore incomplete. I'm sure many more parallels can be found between African traditions and the Bible. Indeed, I hope others may be inspired to explore this fertile ground, which has been fruitful for me and, I hope, may be equally fruitful for others. After all, I am merely an outsider struck by the beautiful and profound insights offered by these traditions, and I hope my efforts may lead others to a deeper appreciation as well. I draw special inspiration from the many ways that the Proverbs point to connectedness as an essential part of the human condition. How appropriate, since the meaning of the Latin root of the word religion refers to what binds or ties us together. Sometimes understood in other traditions as interbeing, this idea finds a very African expression in the concept of Ubuntu, a Bantu word that reflects an understanding of the interconnectedness of humanity. As Archbishop Desmond Tutu explains, "My humanity is bound up in yours, for we can only be human together." Just as the Proverbs reflect a legacy for all humanity, surely we face a common destiny as well. Our humanity bound up in one another's. Finally, I wish to acknowledge Victoria Smoljar for her legal advice, Reverend Nicole Foster and Reverend Gusti Newquist for their encouragement, and the very significant artistic contributions of Zwao Regu and Syed Asfandiar Alam, Jana Ala, Maria Eugenia Amaria, Caleb Dawit, Lulu Hayanga Fregoni, Karina Monokova, Piali Basu Malik, Xenia Panchenko, and Dorothea Taylor. Language and culture consultants Wale Aziz Adibisi, Ebenezer Adeoyin, Auha Odufa Adokutu, Gracia Asha, Hawaba, Brian Bengonza, Honore Barrera, Ulrich Boyomo, Ibrahim Buba, Jeff Buleli, Emmanuel Ibenya, Afi Benedicti Eklu, Christ Ongbo, Daniela Idadukanda, Priamo Jimenez, Pumzile Mabizela, Morikane Madiba, Christian Maloba, Moiketsi Mamakoko, Michael Chimontz Masson, Tobile Imkitse, Gezu Musisa, Guy Mambuete, Peter Muzerwa, Badara Njai, Sibonga Konke Nyati, Olabisi Ola Donjoye, Christine Onyongo, Mark Enroe Pierre, Aurelien Porcin, Heather Puffett, Sitstrena Rako Toremane Nana, Boutique Melodie Hamananandre, Halimatu Sadia Ridwan, Emmanuel Satongima, Jean-Baptiste, Nebguha Sira Elimine, Marisol, Larry Tatchum, Victor Uchebu, and Darius Viku, editor KB Lafheed, and Ellie Go and the team from iUniverse. Last, I am grateful for Lee Ebersole and Logan Ebersole Morehouse for the ways they bring connectedness to my life every day. Chris Morehouse, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. Proverbs. Golden Rule. What is bad for you is not good for your neighbor. Swahili, Kenya and Tanzania. Treat your neighbor justly and honestly. Swahili, Kenya and Tanzania. What you do not like, do not do unto your neighbor. Twi, Ghana. If you know what hurts yourself, you know what hurts others. Malagasy, Madagascar. O man, what you do not like, do not do to your fellows. Bakongo, Congo and Democratic Republic of Congo. What you do not find acceptable if it were done to you by another, do not do to him or her. Akan, Ghana. What you can't take, do not do unto others. Yoruba, Nigeria. Compare to the following. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Luke 6:31. Commentary and Study Guide. What we know as the Golden Rule exists in beautiful variations across several African cultures. That should not be surprising, since understanding that others' lives and emotions are similar to our own is foundational. It's an essential part of being human, and it finds expression in many traditions. According to one estimate, variations exist in 21 faith traditions around the world. For example, in the Jewish tradition, we have Hillel's words, "That which is hateful to you, do not do to another." That is the whole Torah. The rest is commentary. Go study. Christians also affirm the Golden Rule, which Jesus taught was one of the two greatest commandments. Matthew 22:36-40. Indeed, there has recently been growing interest in expressions of the Golden Rule across various wisdom traditions. It's important, I believe, not to overlook the African versions. Questions for discussion and study. 1. Did these African variations of the Golden Rule surprise you? If so, in what way? 2. How might African lives have been shaped by these versions of the Golden Rule? And 3. What can we learn from the African understandings of the Golden Rule? Seeking. God spoke, "Ask me and I'll give you." Swahili, Kenya, and Tanzania. Asking the way doesn't mean one is lost. Haiti. Compare to the following. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. John 16:24. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Matthew 7:7. Commentary and Study Guide. In this Swahili proverb, there's a striking resonance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.